morning and welcome once again to our online Sunday service. Thank you very, very much for joining us. We're happy that you're here. We're happy that you tuned in and we know that you're going to be blessed. Let's go ahead right now to have a time of worship. Sing along with us, worship with us. And then afterwards, our pastor, Pastor Sola Mabogunje, will give us the word today. Thank you for joining us once again. God bless you.
Watching us now, and when it looks as if we can't win, wrap us in your arms and step in, and everything we need you to supply. You got this in control, and now we know that you made us. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. You made a way. Now we're here from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. You are God from beginning to the end. There's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. Times and seasons in your hands. You called for light out of darkness. You don't need a man to be the God you are, but you have chosen to call me your own. Oh, you are.
Welcome to our Sunday online service. I hope you had a good week. I know that God has been taking care of you. I know that God has been protecting you. I know that Jehovah Jireh has been providing for you. And we're just grateful for preservation in this period of time. Just before we continue with our message this morning, or with the service this morning, we would like to take a short testimony. Please watch and be blessed.
This is a testimony of divine protection from our sister Ambi Oluwabamishi. During the first phase of the lockdown, 3 weeks ago, the 11th of April to be precise, there was an overnight thunderstorm in our neighborhood. The heavy rains and winds caused a tree around my home to fall, and it crashed just in front of our compound, destroying our neighbor's car and the electricity supply cables attached to our building. Fortunately, power was out at the time, and at this instance, it was a source of relief. All of this happened in the very early hours of the morning. Later that morning, after dawn broke, we called the utility company to take preventive measures by disconnecting our power supply as repairs needed to be carried out on the damaged cables. Unfortunately, their response was slow, and power supply was restored to our area, resulting in a large, loud, and frightening surge of electricity within our building. I want to thank God that the tree did not fall on anyone, the damaged power cables did not lead to a fire incident, and everyone is safe. Glory be to God, our Jehovah Nissi, and our Jehovah Shalom.
Hallelujah. Once again, we can see God's faithfulness in being our shield, in being Jehovah Nissi to us, the Lord our banner, the Lord our defense, our victory. We're really grateful to God for that testimony. Well, I'd like us to bow our heads right now so that we can pray and go into the message. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, I ask that you would touch each and every one of us during the service. Lord, I ask that your word will go forth with power. Let it achieve and accomplish that which you have purposed in the hearts of everyone watching this morning in the name of Jesus. Dear Heavenly Father, let the light of your word shine into our hearts this morning. Father, let it bring strength, let it bring encouragement, let it bring comfort, let it bring direction in the name of Jesus. Blessed Holy Spirit, we welcome you. We thank you for being present in our service this morning. We thank you for being present with everybody watching this service and listening in the name of Jesus. Let the words that come out of my mouth, Lord, find expression in the lives of people, especially marriages, O God. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we have prayed. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, our topic this morning is a very important topic, especially during this lockdown where married couples have to spend a bit more time together. Ideally, couples should be using this opportunity to bond, but for quite a number, it's generated a lot of fights. And so our topic this morning is, why do couples fight in marriage? Hallelujah. The objective is for us to look in a bit more detail as to why people fight in marriage and to look at solutions that God has made available so that we can have better and more peaceful homes. Hallelujah. Now, if you are in any kind of romantic relationship long enough, at some point you and your spouse or your partner are going to fight. It's not a curse. It's just a fact. Any long-term committed relationship is hard. Even though there are massive benefits to them, it is still challenging to live with somebody day in, day out without having disagreements or fights. Now, we have to learn to cooperate. We have to learn to negotiate. We have to learn to communicate and connect every single day if we want to keep the relationship thriving. Let me say that again. In order to keep our relationships thriving, we have to learn to cooperate with each other. We have to learn to negotiate with each other. We have to learn to communicate and stay connected every single day. Unfortunately, conflicts are unavoidable. In spite of our best efforts, conflicts are unavoidable. Many couples, however, would rather not fight at all. I'm sure you'll agree with me that no married couple sits down and tell each other, when it's 7 p.m., let us fight. Nobody plans for a lovely evening to degenerate into hurt feelings and into anger. Hallelujah. Our objectives for getting married is definitely not to fight. And nobody plans that I want to look for somebody to spend the rest of my life with, for whom I would like to fight 300 days out of 365 every year. That's not the plan. The plan is to have a peaceful, harmonious relationship. So we look for somebody we feel we can live harmoniously, peacefully together. But to a very large extent, that is not the experience of the average couple. You know, our objective for getting married is definitely not to fight. So the question is, if we are also averse towards fighting with our spouse, why do many married couples fight so much? Now, extensive research has shown that one of the major causes of fights among married couples are unmet needs. One of the major causes of fights amongst married couples are unmet needs. Now, the frequency and the magnitude of these fights that takes place between any married couples is often tied to whether their needs are being met in the marriage or not. The more satisfied the needs of a couple are in a marriage, it has been discovered that the less they fight. And the less satisfied they are, the more they actually fight. Now, this is especially true when certain fundamental needs are not being met in a marriage or in any relationship. And these fundamental needs are as follows. The first is a need to feel secure emotionally, financially, physically within a marriage or any relationship. The second is a need to feel accepted and appreciated within a marriage or any relationship. The third is a need for positive affirmation, or should I use the word a need for validation. And the fourth is the need for autonomy within the marriage and not to lose one's sense of identity. This relation between conflict between two or more person and unmet needs, interestingly, can be found in the Bible. You know, this relationship that we said that the more married couples' needs get met in a marriage, the less the fight, and the less they are met, the more they fight, we can actually trace it and find it in the scriptures. If we look at James chapter 4, from verses 1 to 2, I'll be reading from the Good News Translation. Verse 1 says, "Where do all the fights and the quarrels among you come from?" It says, "They come from your desires for pleasure, which are constantly fighting within you." Verse 2, "You want things, but you cannot have them, so you are ready to kill. Strongly desiring things, but you cannot get them, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have what you want because you do not ask God for it." The second example we find in the Bible is in Acts chapter 6, verse 1, when certain members of the early church were being neglected in the daily distribution. If you look at Acts chapter 6, verse 1, it says that now in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. We can see this pattern repeat itself here. We can see that when needs are not met, people have a tendency to fight more. Now, unmet needs, really, I mean, we should ask ourselves a question. Why should unmet needs cause conflict? Why should the fact that my needs are not being met within a marriage cause me to get a bit more aggressive, cause me to actually start to, cause us to start to fight? And the reason is because unmet needs usually cause conflict in relationship because they often generate negative feelings. Think about it. Now, I'm not sure if you think about the Hellenist widows who are being neglected. The needs of the widows in the early church were not being met. Now, if you think about that, I don't think at that point in time the Hellenists had good feelings about the Hebrews. I'm sure if the Bible went into more detail, we would have heard things like the Hebrews are racist. The Hebrews think they are better than everybody. They are snobbish. It will have been generating negative feelings just because their own needs were not met. Now, the thing about negative feelings is the fact that it starts to lead to negative opinions about the person who is supposed to be meeting the need and is not. It starts to generate negative opinions. So negative feelings produce negative opinions. So put it this way, unmet needs produce negative feelings. Negative feelings create negative opinions, and negative opinions promote conflict. You see, because if I have a negative opinion of you, it's going to affect how I talk to you. It's going to affect how I relate with you, which in turn may provoke you to respond negatively towards me. You have to agree that negative usually does not produce a reaction that is positive. And so when the negative meets negative, fights and conflict start. Now, extensive research has discovered that couples even fight significantly more. Listen, I mentioned four needs, but there are so many. But because the one I spoke about with the Hellenists and the Hebrews was food. But they've discovered that couples fight significantly more when these fundamental needs of security, acceptance, affirmation, and autonomy are not met in a marriage or any kind of relationship. So what we want to do is, because we can't cover every possible need, it does make sense for us to take a closer look at these autonomous needs, or rather these fundamental needs, so that we understand them and are better able to recognize and meet them in our marriages. Now, the first need we want to look at is the need to feel secure in your marriage. Now, all of us have a need to feel secure in a marriage or in any relationship. Nobody draws close to somebody you hear wants to kill you. Nobody wants to maintain a relationship when they do not feel physically safe. So when the need for security is not met, either emotionally, financially, or physically, the primary negative emotion they usually trigger is fear. Now, the challenge with fear is the fact that fear would produce its own secondary emotions like anger, shame, or guilt, which usually would lead to a fight or a flight response if not dealt with. Now, anger as a secondary emotion will make us aggressive and cause us to attack our spouse either verbally or physically in extreme cases. I mean, I'm not sure this has ever happened to you. You are driving and somebody, maybe your son, startles you. It's amazing how the secondary emotion of anger is triggered off and you find yourself shouting and getting aggressive at your child. Now, that's what fear does. When the need for security in a marriage are not met, it triggers the primary emotion of fear, and then it moves on to the secondary emotion of anger. Now, in some people, it's guilt, it's shame, and in those cases, rather than attack, they withdraw. Shame actually causes us to withdraw emotionally. Hallelujah. Now, so meeting one another's security need is one of the best ways to build a fulfilling and a long-lasting relationship in a marriage or any relationship, meeting security needs, making each other feel secure emotionally, making each other feel secure financially, making each other feel secure physically is very key to build stable relationships. You know, relationships have been discovered that feel secure, or rather relationships that feel secure are more satisfying, more intimate, and they are less likely to end. They help to satisfy a very fundamental need of every human being to have a secure attachment to another person. It's a fundamental need to have a secure attachment. This need dates back to the day you were born. Whenever a baby is born, that need for attachment is strong, which is why they say that when a mother touches the baby, a mother is encouraged to touch the baby to make that baby feel safe and secure in a relationship. It's interesting that babies, and in the early childhood most especially, have a very strong need for a secure attachment. If this is deprived from any child, the child can grow up to become a needy parent or a clingy individual, and sometimes some people may find that too much. But essentially, that need for attachment, that need for a secure relationship, is fundamental for all of us. You know, so it's a good thing, therefore, to say and do things in our marriage relationship that assure our spouse or our significant other that they are safe with us. It's a good thing to say things and do things that makes our spouse feel secure in their relationship with us, and that they are safe with us emotionally, financially, and physically, and that we will not hurt them. So serious, listen to me. Making statements like, "I'm going to leave this marriage," when you are angry, it's a bad idea. What you're going to do with that statement, every time you make it, you're going to make your spouse feel more insecure when they are with you. And this is just going to lead to more fights. I know that we sometimes say these things for control. You know, we want to threaten our spouse that if you don't behave yourself, I'm going to leave. Now, what you are actually doing is not securing your position in that marriage. You are destroying your home. And if you are not careful and you say it long enough, you just might have what you are saying. Hallelujah. The next one we want to look at, the next fundamental need that needs to be met in any marriage for it to be enjoyable and satisfactory, is the need for acceptance. Now, any relationship benefits when we feel fundamentally accepted by our spouse. Now, acceptance doesn't mean that we are validating or approving bad behavior. It just means we choose to love our spouse in spite of their sometimes many flaws, recognizing that we have our own flaws and we are not perfect. You know, married couples are in a particularly powerful place to protect or to practice acceptance, because we have seen each other at our very worst without the filter of social acceptability that we put on for the rest of the world. You know, being accepted with all of our flaws makes us feel valuable. It actually helps us to become a better person. Now, a note of caution here. We really need to stop to define our spouse by their flaws. You know, it's amazing how just because our spouse has one or two flaws we don't like. For example, the spouse is not tidy. And so we somehow forget about all their other good attributes. We forget that that spouse is a good mother, or we forget that that spouse is a good husband, or the spouse is good at other things, the only thing we see is this untidy person. And that definition, listen, influences how we relate to our spouse subsequently. It's not good. We should not do that. We should actually begin to look at other sides. We should recognize that we have flaws, and this is an area of flaw of our spouse, but this does not define our spouse. We can define them by more positive attributes than the negative. See, that definition, that defining our spouse by negative qualities that causes us to get aggressive towards them, that causes us to sometimes be cruel towards them because all we see is untidy. Hallelujah. So please let's learn to accept one another. It will make your spouse a better person. Acceptance is so powerful because, listen, criticism usually has the intention of trying to correct bad behavior. But the effect of criticism is usually that it establishes the behavior. It makes it 10 times more difficult for the person who has the flaw to change than if they were accepted by their spouse. It doesn't mean you are approving of the behavior. You are simply telling your spouse, I love you in spite of your flaws. Now that builds your spouse's confidence. That makes your spouse interestingly feel a lot more secure with you. And the better your spouse feels about themselves, it's been proven that there's a relationship between good behavior and self-esteem. So as their esteem builds because you are not constantly criticizing them and calling them names according to their flaws, instead you are affirming your spouse, they will begin to change and become a better person. Which leads us to the third need, the need for positive affirmation. Now, most of us would not be satisfied simply knowing that we are just accepted. You can imagine your spouse telling you that you are just accepted with all your flaws. That's the only thing that is holding you together. Many of us will not, that will not be enough. It's good. It's good to be accepted, but we need more than that. We would like to know that our spouse likes us. We want to know that our spouse loves us. We don't just want to know they accept us. Because sometimes it's not enough. We want to know that they like us. We need to feel a sense of warmth and affection. Not just, I accept your many, many flaws, but you are very, they need to hear, you are very important to me and I love and respect you. They need to hear it. Now, this kind of warmth from a spouse can help their husband or wife start to develop more positive feelings about themselves. And like acceptance, it leads to a virtuous cycle in which they actually become a better spouse. Listen to this. Which in turn will make you like them better. So listen to me. Constant criticism, like I said earlier, will destroy self-esteem. I need to repeat that. And will increase the need for acceptance and affirmation in your spouse. Listen, the more you criticize your spouse, the more they're going to need, their need for acceptance, their need for security is going to grow. In short, criticism heightens fear. It heightens insecurity. And the problem with that is that, like I said earlier, once you start triggering fear in anybody, aggression comes. So quite a number of times, a lot of the animosity and the aggression we sometimes may see in married couples have their root in the fear that their need for security, their need for acceptance, their need for affirmation may never be met, so they fight. Usually it starts with a complaint. When the complaint is ignored, they get frustrated. And in trying to get their needs met, they begin to fight. You may be surprised that aggressive spouse that you have called a tiger in the house, all they need is affirmation. All they need is to constantly be assured that they are loved. You know, my great-grandmother, when you see her for the first time, my grandmother, when you see her for the first time, you think she's tough. But I discovered that if I hugged her, she will just melt. And so all that toughness I realized that behind all the toughness was a need for affirmation, was a need to feel loved, was a need for to have a secure, loving relationship with her, with people around her. Hallelujah. Amen. So we will achieve more in terms of making our spouse a better person with positive affirmation and acceptance than with criticism. Praise the Lord. Let me give you a basic rule. You have not earned the right to criticize your spouse if you have not praised and affirmed them 10 times more. Let's move to the fourth one, autonomy. Now, one of the fundamental human needs is a need to be in control of our actions. Nobody wants their actions and their decisions always controlled by another person. Research has shown that most people were more satisfied with their relationships when they felt overly controlled by their spouse. This kind of situation usually occurs when one person feels they are better than their spouse. So they tend to think their ideas and decisions are always right. So the tendency is to micromanage their spouse, micromanage their actions, which most times would result in bitter fights. Now, you see, what is interesting about the person who is controlling is that they think they are helping their husband or wife. So let me say this to you. The truth is that any help that is not appreciated or asked for is no longer help. It's called interference. So hear me, back off. If the person does not need your help, don't force it on them. You know, the other scenario, of course, of control is those ones are usually a bit more damaging. Yeah, are the fear-driven controlling spouse who sometimes have this fear that their spouse would leave them. You know, these are people, like I mentioned, that did not have that primary secure attachment in early childhood and when they were born. And so they are afraid, or they've had nasty experiences in relationship. Now that fear, you know, fear makes us want to control things around us. So that fear makes them want to control where their spouse goes, who their spouse talks to, and in the process suffocate the spouse. Now, if people like that tend to look for people they can control, they're not likely to want to marry somebody who will stand their ground, because if they do, they will fight every day. You know, so unfortunately, that kind of relationship tends to be abusive. And the person who is yielding to that kind of control usually gets damaged emotionally. So, but if for whatever reason that person gets to their own breaking point, and is no longer willing to accept that kind of control and starts to stand up, fights will ensue for quite a while until the controller starts backing down. But that's another scenario. Listen, marriage needs compromise. A lot of give and take is required for our marriages to survive. You can't always have your way. I mean, you can't, no matter how well better you think you are than your spouse, they still have things you don't have. The reason God allowed two to become one is because it was not good that you are alone, which means that you are not all in all. Your spouse has ideas that are better than yours. And sometimes you need to let go. You say you want to help. You want to help. Let them make their mistake. Listen to me. If you don't let them have their way, they're not going to appreciate your own ideas. So if you always want to force yours on your spouse, they will resent it. So let them make the mistake. And listen, two things can happen. They may take that decision and it may be better than yours, which will make you start to relax and realize you can start, it will help you to start trusting your spouse's judgment. And then both of you can come together and put heads together, join your ideas together to come up with better decisions. Hallelujah. So listen, let's not take each other's needs for granted. The truth to remember about some of the things that I'm saying here is that you will never get the best from a dissatisfied and an unhappy spouse. That's what I'm saying. You're making your spouse unhappy deliberately is not a good idea. You are harming yourself. You are sowing the seeds for your own unhappiness. So as such, we must never take our spouse's needs for granted. And listen to me, that sounds logical, but in practice, it happens so often. By the time we get caught up in daily work and we're so wrapped up in our own lives, we forget. Unfortunately, like I said, many of us have become so engrossed in having our own needs met that we are no longer even aware of the needs of your spouse. I mean, if I asked you today, what are the four critical needs of your spouse? Do you know them? You know, we don't, and then, you know, when our spouses complain, we don't even connect the dots that we are largely responsible for our spouse's unhappiness. When they complain, like I said, because we have starved them, we turn the tables around and start telling our spouse that they are the problems. Their problem is too much. They are too problematic. They are always complaining. They are never satisfied. And you know, as we say in Nigeria, your problem is too much. You know, instead of listening, so when your spouse complains, I know that complaining is not pleasant to hear. And, you know, sometimes when you are listening, you are irritated. You see, after all that irritation, calm down. Think about it. That complaint is a need. They may not always have expressed it well, but that complaint is bringing out a fundamental need that they have and that is hurting them. So, like I said, if your spouse is not happy, you will not be happy. Now, I'm not suggesting we can meet all the needs of our spouse. We're not El Shaddai. But we should at least let our spouse know we care about their happiness and about their well-being. You see, when they see us at least making an effort, we communicate we care. So I just want us to look at a few tips on some of the things we can do to meet these fundamental needs in our marriages. If you can at least meet these needs to some degree, it will bring a measure of stability and satisfaction in your marriage. And so my first tip towards effectively meeting your spouse's needs is to ask them. Don't assume you know. You know, some of us, I don't understand. We think we know our spouse, and you just might not. So my first counsel is ask them. You know, so if we want a stronger, more fulfilling relationships, the best place to start is to ask our spouse what they need. Now listen, some of them may never even have thought about it. They just know they are happy. They don't know why. They may never have thought about it themselves. So being asked gives them an opportunity to actually start to identify unmet needs in their life and that are actually generating the negative feelings that is causing the fights in the marriage. When you just ask your spouse, look, what are the needs in your life I'm not meeting? It's amazing. You know, we just know how we feel. We don't know what's causing it. Very few of us take time to get to know ourselves. So how do we expect somebody else to know us? So ask your spouse. Let them start to identify the actual needs that they have, things that they want you to do in their lives that they have not even thought about. Now, you see, so this question that you would ask would also signal to your spouse that you care about their well-being, asking about their needs. It's amazing. Not many married couples do that. What do you need? Are there things in your life I'm not meeting? It's not something we hear often. And so it signals to your spouse that you care. Now, you also need to consider your own needs. You need to think about it. What is missing in your relationship? In areas of security, in areas of acceptance, in areas of affirmation, in areas of autonomy, or any other area, what's missing? If you take an audit of your relationship, what is missing? look at it. Now, bear in mind while I'm saying this, that unmet needs can affect us even if we're not aware of them. It's like babies or younger children, for example, they may act up or throw tantrums or get cranky because they are tired. However, if you take them to their bed to try and get them to sleep, they will insist they're not tired. That's how unmet needs sometimes are. You may not be aware of them, but they're the ones fueling all these negative emotions and animosity you have towards your spouse. It's amazing how if your spouse starts to do things that are meeting those needs, you just find yourself calming down. You find your emotions changing. So try and write your needs down. Try and put them in writing. And somebody says, why? You say, because, like I said earlier, if you don't understand yourself, how do you explain yourself to somebody else? It's difficult for someone else to understand you when you don't even understand yourself. I mean, if you want me to meet a need and you don't know the need, exactly how am I going to meet that need? Hallelujah. And you see, when you don't articulate your needs, your emotions go haywire. You will not know why the emotions, you see, not knowing the root cause of an emotion makes it take more control in your life. All right, so after you put this down, you need to consider sharing this need with your spouse in a mutually supportive way. And let me make this advice. When you want to share this need, first of all, start by asking your spouse about their needs. Don't start by sharing your needs. If you start that way, you might communicate to your spouse that all you think about is your way. And if you're not careful, you will get your spouse defensive because they will think you are telling them they are not measuring up. So it's always best to start out by asking about their own needs. Now, another way you can, other things you can do to make your spouse, to meet your spouse's fundamental needs, especially the need to feel secure, the need to feel affirmed, is to learn to acknowledge and notice your spouse. And you know, the way you do this is by appreciating the things that they do in the marriage. I've heard many married couples feel, I mean, sometimes the ladies tell the husband, "Am I your house girl?" Which means that he doesn't even appreciate what they're doing in the house. Learn to show affection by periodically holding, touching, hugging, smiling at him or her, even when you are busy. See, even when you are busy, just looking at your spouse, give them a smile, or get up, hug them, and then go back to what you're doing. That is, let them know you see them. Let them know you appreciate them. Make extra effort to make your spouse know that you notice them. For women, compliment her dress, her hair, the way she looks. It will amaze you that the impact these seemingly insignificant physical gestures will have to make your spouse feel noticed and secure. Now listen, without this regular acknowledgement of their presence in your marriage, your spouse may start to feel ignored, alone, unappreciated, and insecure. For men, listen, if you lose your job, don't stop trying to find a way to get a steady job. You see, that effort communicates to your wife you care about her financial security. It's a way, you see, even if you are not getting it, but she sees the effort being put in, it makes her feel secure that at least you care. So she makes a lot more allowance for that. And then communicate during this period of time. Let her know what you're doing. I know it's not that easy, but if she doesn't know, she will assume the worst. So it makes sense to communicate to her what you're doing to try and secure the home financially. So communicate with her, let her know. Pray about the situation. pray with her about the situation. That's not the time for you to lock yourself up in a room and she doesn't know what's happening to you. Both of you get on your knees and pray to God about the situation. Then the next morning, go out and go together. If you come back discouraged like the apostle, come back to your own company and you guys pray together. Hallelujah. Another tip is we should learn to actually, as a habit, respond to our spouse's needs. We should form a habit of responding as best as you can. Listen, don't think it doesn't matter. Your spouse needs to feel a willingness on your part to meet their needs. You see, your spouse needs to feel that their needs are important to you. That if they are hurting at any point in time, you will stop everything you are doing and listen to them. Knowing you are available and responsive to their pain or needs will build trust in your spouse and will make them feel a lot more secure with you. It means, you see, you communicate to them that they are important. Another tip is learn to communicate your love and appreciation every day. Look for opportunities to let your spouse know that you love and appreciate them. Sometimes we might assume they should know, especially if we've been together for a long time. But sometimes they might just think the opposite. So don't assume. So a good strategy is to regularly let your spouse know that you love them, even when you are angry. You know, you can tell your spouse, look, I don't like what you did and I'm upset with you, but I hope you know I still love you. That assurance will help to make your relationship a lot more satisfying. And then lastly, finally, discuss with your spouse. This is important. Sit with your spouse and ask them areas he or she may feel unable to measure up in their marriage. You might be surprised. Your spouse may be struggling in some areas, feeling inadequate. So sit down and just ask your spouse that question. Are there areas that you feel you are not measuring up, that you are failing, that makes you feel guilty? Is there any way I'm making you feel inadequate? Ask your spouse that question and discuss it. Now, here is the plan. There may be needs that you have that your spouse is struggling with. Don't just leave them to struggle under the weight of that. God's intention is that we should lend a helping hand. We shouldn't just leave our spouse to struggle on their own. So it's best done together. It could be that your spouse is forgetful, and there are certain needs that they have needs that you have that your spouse keeps forgetting. Help them to remember. And then as you do it periodically and regularly, after a while your spouse catches on and then your needs get met. It's better than being upset and frustrated. Hallelujah. So, in conclusion, you know, I find out that couples often get stuck in a loop where neither partner's needs are being met. You know, so it's like, my needs are not met, why should I meet your own? So nobody's needs are being met. Meanwhile, the cycle that actually works is that in which I meet your needs. By meeting your needs, I provoke you to meet mine. Now that's a much better cycle working at. So by making an effort to think about the needs of our spouse and going ahead to meet those needs will set in motion, like I said, a cycle of love that will cause our own needs to be met and create a more harmonious and fulfilling relationships. Finally, pray regularly for your spouse and pray for yourself. Do not underestimate the power of prayer. You will find out that every time I talk about marriage, I always talk about prayer, because there are three people in every marriage. There's the man and the woman and there's God. And when you honor the third person of the marriage and yield to that third person, he will help both of you have the best marriage possible. So, you know, ask God to help you at this time, you know, to love your spouse and better meet their needs. Pray the same thing for your spouse, that their love for you will grow in knowledge and in understanding. Pray about the growth and development of your spouse spiritually, emotionally, intellectually, and financially. You know, because the more mature a person becomes, the better behaved they are, the more you can enjoy being with them. And so pray for better communication in your marriage and more effective conflict resolution. And then I'd like to close with this verse of scripture, chapter 6, verse 2 in the Amplified. It says, carry one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the requirements of the law of Christ, that is the law of Christian love. Let me read that again. Carry one another's burdens. Now, just in case you are not aware, that is what is expected in marriage, that we learn to carry one another's burdens. It's not just to have fun and use the other person. You must be prepared to carry one another's burdens, moral flaws, errors, and still fulfill the requirements of Christ's law, which is to love one another. So let us take our Christianity into our homes and into our marriages and walk in love towards our spouse. This is one of the acid tests of our submission and reverence for God. It is hypocritical for us to behave nicely towards outsiders and then treat those of our household, our wife, our children, with contempt. God will help us. He will help us to love each other. He will help us to be able to be better husbands, better wives. In the name of Jesus, let us pray. I'd like each one of us to lift up our marriages before God. And if you are single, I'd like you to start to pray about any relationship you are in currently. And let's begin to ask God to teach us how to love and meet the need of our spouse or significant other. Let us ask Him to help us to relate and give us the grace to communicate effectively and to be able to express our own needs in a way that is not offensive, and that God strengthens our relationship. While in this attitude of prayer, some of us need to have been hurt in our relationships. I'd like to ask that you ask God to forgive your spouse, and you also release your spouse at this time. Forgive them. They have hurt you. So for you to heal and to be happy, you need to let them go. Forgive your spouse and ask God to be able to help you relate with your spouse again. Father God, I receive emotional healing for people listening to this message at this time. Father, thank you because you are the balm of Gilead. Thank you for healing those emotions in the name of Jesus. Thank you for causing your joy to return to the hearts of people. Lord, thank you also because even when our needs are not being met by our spouse, you remain Jehovah Jireh. We ask that you meet those fundamental needs in the hearts of some people listening tonight, today, and everyone listening, either directly or indirectly in their relationships, in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you praise. Thank you for causing every marriage to thrive. And for those that are going into marriage, Father God, help them to make right choices. Help them to recognize the right person. Help them not to be hasty. Help them to keep in step with you. And Lord, if anybody listening to me is in a wrong relationship, Father, reveal it to them and give them the strength to walk away from it. in the name of Jesus. But for those that are married, that their marriages are on the brink of divorce, I ask that your resurrection life goes into that marriage. The Bible says you are the God that raises the dead. Father, resurrect that broken home in the name of Jesus. We thank you. And if there's anybody listening right now, you don't know Jesus, you want him to come into your life, the good news is that God wants to have a harmonious relationship with you. God wants to be friends with you. The Bible says that to think that God was in Christ reconciling the world back to himself. The Word of God says, for God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. God loves you. And it is sin that has held you back from God, that has blocked the way for you to have a satisfying and fulfilling relationship with God. So God has already paid the price. He has removed the obstacle and is inviting you today to come into a satisfying relationship with him. This is the most important relationship you can have with anybody in this world. And so if you want to accept God's invitation to receive Christ into your heart, to receive forgiveness of sins, to come into a loving relationship with him, there is a label below the screen. I would like you to just click on it at the place where it says click here, and I'll pray with you. So please just, if you've done that, please just pray along with me and say after me, God, in the name of Jesus, I believe that you sent Jesus to die for my sins. I believe that you raised him from the dead to justify me. I receive in my heart forgiveness of sins. I receive Jesus as my Lord and as my Savior. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord, that today I am born again. Thank you because I am your child. In Jesus' mighty name. If you said that prayer, I'd like to welcome you to the family of God. You are born again. Some of you are wondering, is it that easy? Yes, it is. Jesus did all the work on the cross that it might be easy. All you need to do is receive what was always yours. And so once you've done that, I'd like to encourage you to spend time reading your Bible. The Bible says that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. So God's word will feed your spirit, will feed you and help you to grow spiritually and help you to grow in your relationship with God and enjoy all the benefits that God has for you in Christ Jesus. In the same manner, there are those who would want to receive healing today. It's the same thing. The same way we receive salvation is the same way we receive healing, because the Bible says, by the stripes of Jesus, we have been healed. So all you need to do is release your faith and receive what Christ, he has already healed you. He's not trying to heal you. So all you need to do is receive it and say it. The Bible says, with the heart, a man believes to righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made to salvation. Salvation involves healing. It means preservation. It means wholeness. It means deliverance. And so if you believe in your heart that Jesus took your sickness and carried away your diseases on the cross, then pray after me as well and just lift up your hands and say, Father, thank you. Thank you for healing me. And begin to just give him thanks. Mention the sickness and just tell him, Lord, thank you for healing me of that disease, while I pray with you in the authority of the name of Jesus. Lord, for those that have already released their faith, They've released their faith in the finished work of Christ. Lord, in the authority of the name of Jesus, I thank you for removing those sicknesses off their body. I command every sickness, every disease to leave their body at this time in the name of Jesus. I declare that they are healed from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet in the name of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. It's time to give our tithes and offering to the Lord. Let's just pray over our tithes and offerings in the name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you for all the things you have been providing for us. We thank you for the things you've given to us. We thank you for the money that we have, the clothes that we hear, the air that we breathe. And today we bring our tithes and offerings to express our gratitude to you, dear Lord. Thank you so much. We honor you with our seed. We honor you with our tithes. We honor you with our offering, oh God. Thank you because you multiply our seed sown. You cause the heavens to open over us and you pour us out a blessing. Thank you because we will not lack in the time of famine. Lord, we will not see evil when it comes. We thank you because our leaves will remain green in the name of Jesus. We thank you. Lord, we give you all the praise and we give you all the glory. Now, in a few minutes, the bank details are going to come up and you can do your transfer. And afterwards, I will come back to make the announcement. Please don't log out yet. God bless you. God is faithful, and I know that he will not leave us nor forsake us. Let's take our announcements. Today's message will be on SoundCloud after the service. It will be on YouTube. It will be on our website. It will be on Facebook. So please let's go to these platforms and let's listen to them again. If you don't have enough data, go to our SoundCloud page. Just type in Center of Christ Church, it will take you to our page and you can listen to today's message. Please follow us on social media, like and share the punchlines that we posted after the service. Please let's continue to spread this message, message of hope, message of faith. If you know any married couple that needs to hear this, please send this link to them so that they can be blessed. Our junior church service will be holding not too long after this service at 11:30 a.m. on this same platform. You can also go to our YouTube page and you can watch it there. Please let your children, after the adults, please get your children together. The Bible says we should teach our children in the way of the Lord so that when they grow up, they will not depart. Let's start to build strong values in our children by making sure they attend the children's service at 11:30 on this platform. Our midweek service is coming up on Thursday at 7:30 p.m. Please do not miss it. And then our online prayer meetings, I'd like to commend many of us that have begun to join. You know, this is the time to pray. And so We'll be praying again this week, Monday and Wednesday. You know, I just want to say that before any great revival, if you're really hungry for the move of God, if you really want to see the glory of God show forth in your life, show forth in the church, show forth around, and see God manifest with outstanding miracles, then join us on Mondays and Wednesdays. Let's bring down the glory. Let's cause to manifest the glory. And so at 9 p.m. every Monday and every Wednesday, let's log into our free conference call application. You can download it on Google Play Store on Android devices and on the App Store on Apple devices. The instructions of how to do this will come up shortly. And then afterwards, I'll just say a few more things, and we will then share the grace. Finally, please remember to meditate on the word of God. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you will meditate in it day and night, that you might observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and you would have good success. Take scriptures, repeat them, recite them to yourself in the area that you want to see change in your life. At this time, take time to pray and fellowship with God, and check up on each other. Call your parents, check up on friends, call other church members. Stay connected and don't isolate yourself. The Bible says we should not forsake the assembling of one another together, as is the habit of some, especially as we see the day approaching. Avoid sharing unverified information. Do not spread fear, but keep spreading the message of hope. Maintain good personal hygiene. Keep washing those hands. Keep washing those hands and exercise regularly. Let's share the grace in fellowship. The amazing grace of the Master Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, and the intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us. Our closing charge. Thanks be to God, who always leads me in victory through Christ. God uses me to spread his knowledge everywhere like a sweet-smelling perfume. Hallelujah.